Well, welcome, and sort of a beautiful day.
Beautiful day.
Yeah.
Beautiful planet.
You know, I was thinking after our previous talks that what can any human being be truly sure of?
Well, this this certainty can be of the mind, where the head, logical certainty, you know, this is obvious certainties, which are totally uninteresting, because they're more like repeating themselves. A is A, two and two is four, all that. But there's another kind of certainty of the being, and there are different different sources of understanding in our psyche. In our being, we're not in touch with them all. So from that point of view, nobody really understands. I think Socrates had that. He said, people said he was the wisest man in Athens, and he said, "There can't be right. I don't really understand anything." And he made it. He made a distinction. Really, he does say he didn't understand everything. He might know everything, but not understand anything. Is that in the direction of what you're saying?
Right. Well, there you're saying he doesn't perhaps know anything, everything, but he has knowing. It's almost a trust thing, isn't it? It's like a surrender to not knowing brings a certain sense of certainty.
Exactly.
Right. The mystics are the first, it seems to me, the first to say that it's all a mystery.
Yes.
And a sacred, enormous mystery, but they're certain in where they sit. There's a certainty. There's not a doubt. There's not any arrogance with it, or any need to be on top of the subject, but just to relax into the certainty of trust, in a sense.
Yes, it's true. It's a state of being rather than a condition of thought to be part or to be aware that the biggest mystery is myself, and the universe is unknown, and it's often said, which always used to puzzle me when I was growing up studying philosophy, I would hear people say, we live in a world of appearances, we don't really know the reality behind the appearances. And the world is a lot, appears in a certain way, but what is it really in itself without our seeing it? If we weren't here, so this, I said, the world is appearances, but I would go like that. This seems so real. But they would keep saying, especially the mystics, you know, we're seeing a world of appearances. And I only began to understand what that could mean when I recognized that I myself am an appearance to myself. And I don't know if I were in touch with what is behind my own appearances, I might be able to see what is behind the appearances of nature. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It means that there's a certain kind of knowing that is maybe reachable, but not in our ordinary state of being.
Well, that's the dilemma, isn't it? I mean, we're raised in a logical world with logical rules, logical instruction, logical education. And many of us get into this thing of, well, what's the meaning of life? Because logic doesn't really explain the meaning of life, but we try to use those logical processes to get to an answer.
Yes.
And in essence, is that entirely the wrong tool? Because can logic possibly get us to the meaning of life and who I am? Or are we needing to go and find another tool outside of logic? And that kind of befuddles logic.
Well, yeah, I think, yeah. But what do you think, though, to get to that? I think that's good way to start. To get to that, what do you think, for example, which you know you can speak about probably better than anyone, in the state of wonder, there's a certainty and a mystery at the same time, isn't there?
Well, it's ecstasy, isn't it? When you're really in awe, like when you Like if I go surfing and a beautiful wave comes, some days just the waves are unbelievable, and every surfer I know has experienced this. You get this magnificent wave and it's curling and the conditions are perfect and you catch it and you suddenly go into this zone that's outside of thinking. It's ecstasy, and there's a complete lack of doubt. It's like you're there, you're totally there. There's no question of being anywhere else, no question of wanting to be anywhere else. We can experience that in a lot of ways, you know, when you hold a baby, your infant, you know, or there's all sorts of ways to get there. Some people, it's, well, I've been in that in a life-threatening crisis as well, where time stops, and I'm completely there. So is that what we're talking about at those moments? But can you actually find a path to that? To arrive at that, and the spiritual traditions say yes. There's prayer and there's meditation and everything else. It seems to be described by many, 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 many people, many mystics, but it doesn't seem to be described in a way that people can assimilate that description readily and easily. It's almost accidental to come across that.
Seems completely accidental for most of us, and. What isn't described is very often, or sometimes, but not often really, is how fragile that state is, how evanescent, how ephemeral.
Mm-hmm.
And in that moment, you use the phrase, which I think is quite accurate, timeless. To experience timelessness, it doesn't mean you last forever and ever and ever. It means there's no time.
Mm-hmm.
That the mind, the logical mind, cannot grasp that. In fact, there's many things about what we use for our knowing in an ordinary way that is really stupid.
Mm-hmm.
In a way, the mind, ordinary mind, is really doesn't know much about this state. But the question you're asking, I think, is very interesting. Is there a way, a process that one can understand where one can open to that energy, this timeless energy? That could actually enter into our everyday life, isn't that?
Wouldn't it be great when we're at school if somebody gave us a handbook and said, "Well, this is how you do it. This is how you attain ecstasy and at one moment in life. This is how you become a fulfilled being. You know, the maximum of your potential." And yet we do get handed all sorts of books. You know, Catholic Catechism or the Quran or. All sorts of things, or a physics book, and we're told, well, pursue this, this will take you to your fulfillment, or you buy a new car, or whatever it is. But none of those things are efficient methods of finding this sense of infinity, or this dwelling in infinity for these moments that we have that seem to be accidental. And to me, that's remarkable, because it seems to me that just to be a being in this existence, it's almost like our birthright. Because we are, you know, this is infinite, and this is a mystery, and we're part of that, and we're vital parts of it.
Then what we may want to do is to try to study what takes us away from that. Maybe that could be if that could be more understood, if we could begin to be not even attached to the dawnless energy, but something in us could be free to let it go when it goes, and perhaps something in us could exist that could actually see what takes us. It's because I think you're right. You can't write a book on how to get to it,
right?
Nor can you write a book on how to keep it. No, you can't. You write a book about anything, but you can begin to give some pointers about, and maybe there are people in the past or in the present who we don't know, who have gone a little further along that way than we have.
Mm-hmm.
For example, in Australia, the root of the Aboriginal culture, I only came to it very recently, but there's a wisdom in there. Now, that wisdom, they must, these people, or people like that, are not stupider than we are. They must know about what we're talking about.
Right. Right. Well, you know, for me personally, and that's really the only place I can go to when we start talking about this, I've had the great good fortune of growing up in nature and really immersing myself in it. And in that, I've found the greatest peace and the greatest connection and the greatest relaxation and the greatest awe at the mystery of things. And it's really interesting, the more I'm in nature, the less questions I have. And the less I'm in nature, the more questions I have. And, you know, half of humanity now is living in cities. There's not a lot of nature in cities. Well, put it this way, there's nature, we've got ourselves, we've got our pets, we've got our trees and our office plants and things like that. But to live or be for extended periods in a pristine living environment, as it was made, to use that expression, untouched, unspoiled, unaffected by logic and manipulation for whatever ambitions we have. And skin diving is like this. When I go swimming, I'm being in a completely unspoiled environment, completely immersed in it. It's almost womb-like because I'm flying in water. There's no evidence of humanity if I'm in a pristine environment. And I've found that that has kept me rooted in some kind of a trust, in some kind of an expectation that everything's okay. But when I'm not in that environment, then I start to ask more and more questions. And the further away from that environment I am, the more unsettled I am with my condition, the human condition.
Of course. There is such a thing as culture, of civilization, of refinement, of knowledge, of communication, of understanding how to act, ways of acting on the planet, in the world, the creation of art, the development of all sides of human nature, where maybe we're meant to live out in the world and make things and create things, and as many of the mystics and spiritual teachings say, the perfection of nature, bring nature to its perfection. And it sounds unreasonable. Nature is perfect in a way as it is, we would say. But there's something about how they used to define a saint as someone who would be very good and do what's good, but not really understand. And a wise man as someone maybe who has wisdom, but can't really do good sometimes. But a sage was the highest one who understood and could be in that state you're talking about, even when in culture, in civil. You take, for example, you speak of nature, and I envy your upbringing. I mean, I would have loved, I was always going into the woods. But when I went recently, we went to visit Egypt and saw just the remains of this. Wow, my God, this was something. This was something. This was not nature, but it was at least as great as nature.
Right.
And in a way, I would never say it was greater, because obviously it'd be stupid, or even less, but it was as awe-inspiring as the stars at night and the starry sky. So maybe the question is how to be swimming and thinking and creating and at the same time. How to be in Egypt and in the ocean.
Right, right. You know, the old expression, be in the world and not of it. And while you're speaking, I mean, human craftsmanship, I mean, just the act of craftsmanship can be transporting, right? Like doing a painting. If you're really focused and involved, time stops. You suddenly realize 3 hours later, oh my God, 3 hours have gone by, and I was completely absorbed. And I also think of, if you're listening to an orchestra or some music with headphones that you really love, it's transporting and it's transcendental. So, you know, those efforts of humans to craft things, like you're saying, as I'm understanding you're saying, take us there as well.
Yeah.
So it's not just being in wild nature.
Yeah, though that takes some understanding, some knowledge, some conscious intention that one doesn't necessarily have in swimming and in nature. I don't need to work at it. I'm just there.
Right, exactly.
But yeah. There's something in us that maybe needs to be able to work at, to become consciously part of that rather than immersed. And I want, that's not that you're not conscious, but that there may be other states of consciousness which creates the pyramids, which creates the great mm-hmm. art, which mm-hmm. Nature, the earth, may need as much as it needs anything else from us. In other words, it brings us back to the first thing, one of the first things you said. Nobody knows where we came from, why we're here, or where we're going.
Mm-hmm.
None of us does. But think, if we think, everything in nature has a specific purpose, a mm-hmm. specific function, mm-hmm. what used to be called specific good. Everything. And if it's destroyed, and some nature comes in and fixes it in
mm-hmm.
a way.
Mm-hmm.
What's the specific nature of human beings? What is their specific function? Swimming in the ocean cannot be, in my opinion, the whole thing.
Right, right.
So what is you, face the damn question, what is uniquely human? That means maybe what the earth may need from us, or the who knows what. We're here for a purpose. I might agree that nobody or none of you I know knows why, but I'm quite sure there is one.
Right,
And then so our question becomes, how do we discover that?
Don't we all ask, what's our purpose at some point? Who am I? Why am I here? What's our purpose?
Maybe it doesn't, nature may not need all of it. It's producing maybe more than
I think that's a great point, you know, and I've thought about that a few times, you know, because if you look at nature, I try to think of everything, well, you know, what is this in the natural context? Well, you look at coral spores or fungus spores or seeds from an oak tree. Nature's prolific, and it puts out billions of spores and seeds and eggs and so forth, and only a few of them actually get realized into adult.
Tough thinking, isn't it?
Well, because yeah. Is this the human thing?
Is this it? Well,
it
like,
seems to be.
There's a Buddhist teaching which says something about the privilege and specialness of being born as a human being, because it's only the human being who can escape from the world of appearances and illusion.
Right.
And
right.
There are many levels of life. The gods, and then there are the animals and other things, and the hungry ghosts and all mm-hmm. the hells.
Mm-hmm.
But one has to be born as a human, and that is just very rare. And they give an example. Say, you imagine a turtle mm-hmm. swimming in the ocean, which surfaces once every 100 years. What are the odds? And imagine also an ox yoke floating in the water somewhere, and what are the odds when the turtle surfaces that once every 100 years that its head will come right through the yolk?
Mm-hmm.
That's how rare it is mm-hmm. to be born a human.
Mm-hmm.
So I was always puzzled by that, and I was walking in San Francisco with a friend of mine, a Tibetan, a wonderful teacher, a wonderful man, and we were in the rush hour or something, and thousands of people were riding back and forth, bumping into us in a way. I said, Lobsang, why does it say it's so rare to be born, to be a human being? Look at all these thousands mm-hmm. of human beings. And he said to me, and it stopped me in my tracks, he said, how many human beings do you see?
Right, right.
Oh,
yeah,
no.
There you go.
So maybe nature is making up in quantity what it lacks in quality.
Right.
If we were more quality,
interesting,
might be less quantity.
Interesting.
What does it need from us? It must need something. We're speaking, we think, we build. We're not animals in that sense.
Right.
So it must need that specificity. Mm-hmm. And if it's not getting it, then maybe it has to spread it out somewhere, a certain energy. And I think that's one way of looking at the question. Now, but the big question is, how do we, a Lao Tzu or a Christ or Rumi have more, obviously more access to this condition, this energy, this consciousness, whatever we want to call it. How did they get there? How can we get there? Now, that brings us to the whole logic, dialectic, history, roles, principles that govern the discovery of the way or the transmission of the way to others. That's what we need to understand. We need to understand that. We also, most of us know, we don't know what's lied on the other side of death, but some people think they do. But
we're told, right?
There's a great story about that too, but this from the Hindu tradition, it's from the Upanishads, about, I'll make it brief, this young man who goes to visit the king of death, Yama, who's also a great, considered a great god. And for various reasons I can't go into, Yama owes him three favors. And the young man says, oh, please. And Yama gives him the first favor is that he wants something good for his father, and the second favor, something of that kind. And the third favor, he asks Yama, this is the king of death, the underworld, in his land. He says, please tell me what happens after death. And Yama says, no, I can't give you, I can't answer that question. Ask me something, anything, I'll give you anything else. He says, no, that's what I really want. And Yama says, no, I'll give you a million years of life, I'll give you beautiful women, I'll give you jewels and money and power. He goes all through this again. He says, no, what good is all that if I don't know what happens after death? And he goes on, and finally Yama says, all right, I tell you. And he takes him out. And he begins to teach him the way, the path. And he says, there are two paths, and one leads to the great ocean of reality, and to God, whatever they call it. And the other one leads to the moon, to outer darkness. And that's a teaching, a symbol of how deep the wish has to be before you can hope to know these mysteries. So, then it brings us to the question, how do we wish? Do we really wish for that?
Right. What will we do for it?
And what will we do for it? And then I think here we are with at least the beginning of a possible hint.
Right.
How to really go on wishing for that. And for that, I really think we need other friends to work together. I don't think anybody can do it alone.
Right. I'd like to go back just a moment. We got to a point, and that is the purpose of life. And you're talking in a really interesting way about that, and I'd like to open that up again.
Okay.
What do you think the purpose of life is for life in general, but for humans?
For human life, you can't discuss it or come toward the answer to that question without asking, what is man? What is specifically human? What makes us different from animals, really? What is our uniqueness? And I think what you were speaking about at a point about this, what you called ecstasy, which is a misunderstood word very often. Sometimes just cheaply understood as some blubbering happiness or something. It's not that, it's, as you implied, standing outside of the whole thing, being apart from and yet totally engaged at the same time. The means that we, I think this, what's unique about man is consciousness. And what is that? Nobody has an answer to that. That's like electricity. What is consciousness? People say, well, awareness, which is just like saying the same thing about it. So consciousness of oneself is, I think, a direction, a consciousness directed both outward and inward. What I know, what I've learned from people that I am sure were in a higher state of consciousness than I was, that when we're in, approach something of a really refined, higher, more developed state of consciousness, we see that we had no idea in our usual state. We couldn't conceive of what it was like. It's described in words and books and things, but once you taste it, you say, oh, it's like I had no idea. And I think that translates into, by normal extrapolation, we have no idea what man is capable of, what we really can be. And the lives of people like Lao Tzu, or legendary as though many of them are, but even more recent, more, we can have glimpses of truly great, spiritually developed men and women. We realize we have no idea what we're capable of. Now, you can see in your life, which is so varied with nature, with the things, the crafts that you do, the things, how much we're capable of. It's astounding. Look at what man has capable, from the Sphinx to the Mona Lisa to the Beethoven quartets to, and then to bloody war, despoilation of nature. We are an amazing being with both the highest and the lowest that we can imagine. And so I think the purpose of human life from this point of view is like asking, what's the purpose of an acorn? An acorn's purpose is to become an oak, and yet millions of acorns are also useful. They provide the soil for other growth and everything else. So people ask, what's the purpose of an acorn, say? You imagine my theory, I had this kind of story that people didn't know what acorns were. They found them, they say, aren't they beautiful? We're going to put them as decoration in our house. And suddenly, after a while, they begin to crack, and they say, oh, there's a problem with the acorn, it's cracking. Let's find out. And they do a scientific examination. They find the substance Z, which causes the cracking, and they can have now acorns without Z. So now you have acorns which can never crack. Well, we're like that. I think some of our suffering is really meant, can function to help us develop and grow. Another kind of our suffering is closes us down. But we don't have a view of what's possible for us. That's why, so I don't think the purpose of human life, I think, has to do with the kind of establishment on the planet of a quality of consciousness, which maybe conducts higher energies, cosmic rays, I don't know what, onto the planet and go back and back up for both ways. I think we are, as I've come to learn about it, we are transmitting stations of a very special kind, with a very special conscious energy. I've come to learn a little bit about that. We're here to be fully human, not just to correct the mess we've created.
Well, that's it, because the human animal without consciousness is a perfectly viable organism on this earth. You know, it's just another great ape.
Another great ape.
Probably functions quite well, and he doesn't destroy the conditions for life on Earth.
Right, right.
We get consciousness, or a bit of it.
So then, once we got that consciousness, like a bit of it, part of my consciousness is a yearning to be consciously part of the whole, consciously serve something higher. The state of wonder is, I just was recently thinking about that. The state of wonder, which, looking at the starry sky on a dark night, and as a child, and you've experienced this a million times over, I realized that not only was I seeing something great and wished to be part of something great, but I realized that something was seeing me. I didn't forget that was experienced, because the interpretation of wonder is that I was experiencing, I saw something, it was wonderful, I wanted to be part of it. But like you were talking about when you were swimming under the ocean, it was calling to me. It was seeing, it was coming down to me. And I had very few but very unforgettable experiences that you had more than anyone maybe, is that in a certain state of presence, nature is speaking to you. The trees are speaking, not in words obviously, but they are there. There is now that, if we could come to that, and we would be a big step for mankind.
Exactly. And I have to tell you, just in my own experience, in my own limited way, invention, and what I've read about other people with their creativity, when I invent something, it's not like I invent something. It's really got nothing to do with me. It's like if I'm in the right conditions, if I'm still, if I'm not distracted by things, when an invention comes, it comes from somewhere that I'm not aware of.
So that's important.
It comes to me. Something speaks to me.
But you prepare for it.
I prepare for it. Usually I prepare for it by making sure I'm in a still, quiet state.
Well, that's
of mind.
Something. That's something. It just doesn't.
So I can listen.
Yeah, so you can listen. It doesn't just, in the middle of watching TV, it doesn't come down.
Right.
You have to wish for it. Your state has to be open. There's the saying that I quote all the time, it is St. Augustine, it's not the one who said it, but that God provides the wind, man must raise the sail.
Oh, I like that.
Isn't that?
Yeah, I like that.
What does it mean to raise the sail?
Mm-hmm.
There may be a great knowledge about that we can find some people to tap into. That, I believe, exists.
Right.
I think it was in ancient Egypt. I think it was probably in Tibet, and who knows where else, where it may still exist. And maybe it's here in this culture, this dying culture. Maybe it's here waiting for us in a way. I'm convinced there's something still looking for us. But, well, what I'm trying to understand is through kind of the conversations that you and I are now having, how to bring really great ideas into the world a little bit more to other people, because younger people especially are not learning about, call it God, in any way that is really, on the whole, very helpful.
And engaging.
Engaging,
right.
Yeah.
And not just engaging, but you must have it.
You must have it.
You must have it. I mean, what is life without it? You know, like Socrates said, the unexamined life is not worth living. I cannot even contemplate what this life would have been for me without that path, without
really,
the yearning.
Really.
Yeah. And we're all born with yearning, it seems. All humans have yearning, you know, and it can be deflected into different areas. And for some people, that becomes almost an obsession, and it has to be an obsession, I think. Well, for me, it has been.
Yeah. Well, I think it's true. It's part of human nature. It's an essential part of our nature.
Right.
And in fact, it's probably the most, among the most essential things that define us, more than our biology. It's what our biology is carrying. It's the biology is the carriage. The yearning is the passenger, sort of, in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody has a yearning, but maybe all desire at one point, all serious, unforced desire is a version of the yearning for this.
I think that's the sense that I get from it, is that here's the animal, here's the brain, here's the possibility of consciousness, and here is a life force. It's the yearning for God, for sake of another word. And I think that's part of the issue. You know, in the indigenous cultures, children are brought up with that yearning directed towards God, to spirituality, to at-one-ment. And in our more modern societies, that yearning is not directed as well.
No.
And it can get kind of messed up, and it can be put into all sorts of obscenities or less than optimum things. And for some people, somehow or other, it ends up in the pursuit of spirituality.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, so often very accidentally.
We're talking about the whole question of education.
Right.
And it starts early in the indigenous societies, and not all indigenous societies are sacred. I mean, Colin Turnbull's book, The People of the Forest, about the pygmies, what a wonderful, but he also wrote a book called The Ick, I-K, about a decayed of tribal society.
Okay.
And mm-hmm. its decay was almost a mirror of what's happening
in the West,
culture,
yeah.
in our culture too.
Right.
But so there may be certain sentimentality about so-called primitive people, but some of the people of the forest, some of the people, indigenous cultures, are, as you say, are far more advanced in their being than we are. We may be far more advanced in our minds, in our egos, in our personality. We can, but our being, our essential nature, may be still very undeveloped.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And how to bring it, so education is a broad word, but also the whole problem of nature deficiency.
Mm-hmm.
You've heard that phrase.
Right, yeah.
Children have this, yeah. so nature deficiency.
Well, here's the thing with our, you know, with education, what is it? It's to pump out people that can serve the, you know, the economic machine,
yeah.
right? And whenever there's any kind of economic crunch, what do? Is close down the arts, close down anything that's really not related to math and science. So education itself becomes the issue, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It's a big exclusive. Issue. It's poorly directed in some respects.
In many respects, it's poorly directed. There's a phrase in one of the Sufi scholar, eyes of flesh and eyes of fire. And the eyes of fire see this God, the purpose, meaning, as well as the medicinal plants and all the rest of the thing. It's all seen from the heart and the mind working, and the body working together. Eyes of flesh are the material things, which we also need.
Mm-hmm.
We need to do the. In your work, seem to have this, the juxtaposition is unusual, of the eyes of fire seeing the beauty and the order, the miraculous order of nature. At the same time, its possibility in the economic and culture and survival life of the human community, of the sustainability, all this kind of thing. You see the pragmatic aspect at the same time you see the spiritual aspect of things. That's very unusual, I think. Don't you think?
Well, I don't know. All I can know I peer out from these eyes that the world's peering into, right? So all I can see is how I experience things and how I see the results of 7 billion people living on Earth affecting the Earth. So it seems to me we're creatures of appetite. In fact, all the creatures of the Earth are creatures of appetite. There's a whole host of appetites. There's survival and sex and food and, you know, pleasure or whatever, so an avoidance of pain. So they're the driving forces of organisms. And humans are no exception. Our appetites are more complex and harder to gratify, it seems. But in answer to what you were just asking, and this is maybe a loose way of coming back to it, it seems to me that if we can get those appetites aligned into something positive, into something whole, something holistic, and that atonement, you know, I just love that word. You know, Christianity calls it atonement,
yeah.
which I think puts a different bent on
Very
it.
Very different, but, yeah.
But what was Christ saying? He was saying atonement, you know. So if we can't suppress appetites, and I don't think that's a useful effort, right? But if we can align those appetites so that they get satisfied by coming to a holistic conclusion, we have this sacred place held in sacred consciousness.
It's a big word, if.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
And if, that's where dreams begin. And we need reality. If we could align all those appetites to correspond to the whole, the need of the whole being, yes, that would answer everything. So the question is, how to do it? How, where do we begin? What knowledge is needed? What experience is needed? What ideas are needed? What methods, practical methods like meditation, whatever they're needed. What one needs is a whole teaching that can help us.
Exactly.
Really, ideas that come from another level, practices that are proved. The fathers of the church and the fathers of the tradition in the deserts of North Africa in the early centuries. I asked once an Orthodox archbishop who was a very spiritual man, very strong man, where did it come from, the postures that of prayer, that who invented them and how, where was it handed down, all these different things that the Orthodox tradition still has, which not so much in the Western now. He said, well, the fathers of the church, fathers of the tradition, found out that when they were in a certain posture, when they were praying deeply meaningful, they happened to find themselves into a posture. Mm-hmm. So that was the posture. Mm. It was an experience. Mm. It was through experience that they found these things together, and it became the tradition. Now, that doesn't mean that we have to follow each everything, but how to find by ourselves that which is the universal, ultimate practice that would lead to all these things. Mm-hmm. It's a single paradox. We need to be able to find it for ourselves, but we need to have it handed to us also.
Right, right.
So those two together.
Well, the rails, the train to go on. Right,
yes,
need to be given to us.
Right. Yeah. And we have it in ourselves, but we also need the help of the past. But the past can be frozen and it can be poorly taught. So we need people of greater being among us. And are they there? How are we searching for them? How will we find them? Then becomes a viable question that people can begin to exchange about. And my guess is that if people get serious in their own little community, whatever it is, with this question becomes a burning question, we will be found. The students ask me this all the time, particularly now in California, that so many spiritual guides and presenting themselves. And not all of them are authentic, but some of them are. And they ask, how do we recognize a real teacher, a real guide? And it always comes back to the question is, how intense are you searching for it?
Mm-hmm.
How are you looking for it? What are you, and if you do come across it, what's your response? Is it gullibility? Will you just swallow it into some bullshit? Or is it cynicism, which you don't really believe it can happen and you don't? How to be open without being gullible?
Right.
How to be critical without being cynical? This is the art of searching, I think.
And it's not a safe game.
No.
I mean, really, if you're really committed, you have to risk everything. And that means that you're probably going to get tricked and you're going to get waylaid and you're going to get, all of the old grail tales.
But it does matter, though, at the same time, if you're committed to the search, not to the guru yet.
Right.
Because that's the point.
Right.
I can be committed to the search, but not to that or that guy. To that one man or woman who seems to have it. Then I've got to be careful and test the person, test myself with the person, but test the person. Then don't invest so much at the beginning. It's like a business in a way. You don't start by investing all your money.
Right.
You maybe invest a little. You just follow the person, talk to them, see. Maybe little by little you begin. Then there may come a moment when it's absolutely sure. This is it. This is important. So young people we all need to hear this kind of thing, because a lot of people are fooled and gullible, go into something and they waste years. And at the same time, this is a time when there are teachers out there. Maybe it couldn't happen 100 years ago or something. The society was different. Maybe I like to think, and I hope it's not sentimental, the time is so critical now that there's a line of poetry from a famous German poet, Hölderlin, where he says, where the danger is greatest, there the helping powers grow.
Right.
And I have a feeling this is a time.
Right.
Like that. So how do you search? How do I search? I was given something and I turned it away from myself for a long time, and took me a long time to begin to open to what is possible. So I wonder if there isn't a certain amount of luck. Do you believe in luck?
Well, what is luck? You know, for me, I think it's grace. I think anything that's luck, I'd have to say, well, maybe that's grace.
That's interesting because I've made a little survey, very unscientific, of asking all kinds of people, even people down and out, lost. Do you consider yourself a lucky person? Almost everyone says yes.
Mm-hmm. Isn't that great?
There are those who know they're not, and then mm-hmm. they destroy themselves sometimes. But the man who is absolutely nothing, an ordinary, normal guy, do you consider yourself lucky? I have this wonderful child, this wonderful wife. I'm very lucky.
And you find people saying that in Africa and India and Indonesia?
Yes.
Right.
So, grace, then we get to the laws of grace. And there must be laws, their law. It's like the sail and the wind, grace. Because the sail is effort. The wind is grace.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So how do we raise our sails in life? Mm-hmm. That's in that way.
Yeah, because, is it just luck? Is it just random that, because what gets a child or a teenager to say, I want enlightenment for sake of a word, or I want atonement. I want to be living in a life of grace, and to have that as the strongest objective in life. What happens in a child or a teenager that, or an adult of any age, where that actually happens? Because it doesn't seem to happen to everybody.
No, but more and more, I think it's the wish for enlightenment may take the form, especially when we're young, I want to help. What can I do to help? I see this world, this mm-hmm. environment, nature is being despoiled. Great animals slaughtered and killed for egoistic purposes. All the things, the war, the poverty, the injustice, the incredible suffering going on. How can I help?
Mm-hmm.
I think that is the beginning of I want enlightenment.
And I think most kids actually feel that, don't they?
I think so.
We probably all do at some level.
Well, I don't know if they would say, I want enlightenment so much as they would say, I want to help.
Want to make a difference.
I want to make a difference.
It
can turn into an ego trip. It can turn into the usual political story, people disagreeing and agreeing, everything. Of course, one saying I just came across from a well-known French poet, everything starts in mysticism and ends in politics.
So well, that's interesting.
It's interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
But the younger people want to help, and that needs to be honored. And others maybe even say, and I want to understand, and that needs to be honored.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be enlightened. That how to honor these things in respect the question rather than try to make up an answer or put it off as being not realistic.
Mm-hmm. You know, sitting with you and knowing you now for a little while, you're clearly a man of wisdom. And what a wonderful place, right? And you know, somebody asked me many, many years ago what I wanted out of life, and I said I wanted to die a wise man. Actually, I'd like to be a wise man before I died, but but you know, I see you and you exude wisdom. You have a wonderful presence. I'd like to ask you if you feel settled, if you feel frustrated, if you feel angst about the state of the world or education of young people, or what are the things, does anything keep you up at night? Or have you found that place that maybe we all seek in our hearts?
Well, I would say that there's many aspects of this question. I'm a human being. I have needs. I have quirks. I have neuroses, like almost all of us. But one thing that I do find is clear for me, that hasn't been cleared in a certain amount of my life, is that I wish to help other, and particularly younger people, but anyone who can, to find the possibilities of the meaning of life that I have found in my work with great ideas and practices. And that, in that sense, and perhaps only in that sense, I'm completely at ease with what I think, what I wish to give to others. I'm completely not satisfied, but in a different sense than perhaps it is in ordinary life, but not satisfied with my understanding, with how much, how far I have to go yet to really say I understand. And I think that is probably a good thing. If I were completely satisfied with that, I would either be a transformed human being or a complete idiot. And maybe I'm happy I'm neither. Well, I'm done. So, but there's a different kind of dissatisfaction than I'm not, I feel frustrated, I haven't gotten my life purpose, I haven't achieved fame, I haven't achieved recognition. I'm worried about what's going to happen to me in the future. All that, possibly. I have some of that worries about the future, like we all do, and about my own personal future, and all my own health, and things of that kind. But there's another kind of dissatisfaction, which is part of the yearning. It's part of this holy impulse called Plato called Eros, which is the love of truth, the love of being. And it's not a dissatisfaction that says to me, you deserve better, and or you've missed the boat, or you could have done better and you should have, and you really should feel guilty about it. It's not quite that. The more what little I have understood, the more I realize how much I don't understand. So I'm not satisfied in that sense, but I respect this dissatisfaction because I think it's part of a true perception of the scale of possibility for myself and as a human being. So I'm without trying to be tricky about it, I'm not dissatisfied that I'm dissatisfied.
Right, right.
I think it's when I feel satisfied with that, then life comes along and shows me, you see, you didn't know as much as you thought you knew. You were not what you thought you are. You still have this ego. You still have this anger. You still have this self-pity. You still have all those things. So satisfaction, in that sense, would be a blanket over the truth. So there must be then a distinction between what you might call, using a technical term, or they could say maybe not technical, mystical dissatisfaction and egoistic dissatisfaction. And I hope my dissatisfaction is more the mystical, but there's a lot of the other too. I can't answer it any better for the moment, but I warn you, I will answer it more fully later.
I love that. Well, you know, you answer a great deal with a smile on your face.
Okay. No, it's. I can't imagine any other purpose in life than the one I've discovered after all these years.
Right. If you had just a minute or a couple of minutes, and you've got some young people in front of you, teenagers, thinking kids, you know, maybe 14, 15, 16, and you're going to tell them how to get the maximum out of this life. Maximum being, you know, fulfillment, if you like, to realization of their best potential. Is there something you could say to them in a short message?
I would try to, with young people who ask me something like that, it's really a reasonable question to ask somebody who seems to be their mentor or seems to have come to something they admire, and that's good, I think. It's incumbent upon someone who's like in that situation to them to try to respond to it in some way. But I would need to take some time.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they would feel that the time I took gave a certain seriousness to their question.
Mm-hmm.
That I didn't have a simple answer to give them, that I was pondering and taking it very seriously. And I would try to look at them and try to receive them as impressions to come into me, trying to sort of open myself to them as much as I could, and not to judge them or anything about their looks or anything of that kind, but to try to feel the seriousness of their question. And if I felt it was serious, as it probably was, I would say, when you, and it sounds like the Buddha's answer, but it isn't, when you meet someone who you feel has a certain quality that is, touches you, try to speak to them and ask them this kind of question. But before you do that, try to watch them. Don't particularly judge anything, but just watch them move, watch them speak, watch how they are with people, watch how they are with money, with time, with sex, with all the things. Just observe them, and particularly observe how they and whether they listen to other people. Because in a way, listening is a real work, is a real art.
Mm.
It isn't just waiting for the other person to stop and before you speak and get back or whatever. It means letting them in. And I would say listening, that work of listening, is the first step of love. Not love that is impossible, not love that is sentimental, not love that is God's love for man, so high a thing, but human love is what's needed in all everywhere, and it can't be gotten quickly. But to listen to another person and let them in before you respond, sometimes just a little bit, is the first plank in a bridge that leads from ego to love. And I think you would find your whole, most of the problems and difficulties in our life are due to communication not being managed at all, not being taking place. That means that listening not being done. And if I gave you one thing to practice, I would say practice the work of letting another person in, like you would invite a guest into your house and serve them tea or something. Let them in, receive them, and try to separate from your own thoughts for a minute or two or three, which is possible for anyone. Let them in, and then respond. If you try that a little bit, or try that enough, I think you'll find that that's a very important step to what you're asking for. But that's, in the
nice,
moment, that's all I would say.
And the corollary to that, I guess, is that if you take a moment to listen, then you're also aware of your own reactions.
Exactly.
And your own reactions are perhaps the single biggest thing that separates us from this place that we would all like to be in.
That's the secret behind listening, is that when you really work at listening, you wind up listening to yourself. Yeah. And when you see that, then you change.